Hi folks, and welcome back to the workshop. I thought it was about time that I rebuilt WRD's original transmission, and I thought I'd start with the transfer box as I did the last time. Last time around, I filmed some of the job, but it was more of a sort of updates as we went along. And what I'd like to do is show some of the work being done this time, if possible. Time is always limited for this kind of thing. We'll see how we go. I'll start uploading the video in parts and we'll just see where we get to. So hopefully a more time-honoured approach than the last one. I'll throw in some photographs of the transfer box when it was still installed in the vehicle. I'm not sure that it had ever been out in recent times, and you'll appreciate how much work it's taken to get it this clean. Now, there's no magic solution that will do that for you. It's just a case of setting to with nylon brushes and Scotch-Brite and good degreasers. But worthwhile, I think. This transfer box is a suffix D, so quite a late one. Quite desirable, really. They had various improvements over the earlier types. The transfer box really remained relatively unchanged from the very early Land Rovers. The gearbox is more so. We'll come to that later on. The gearbox will sort of be a separate series, and it'll ultimately all merge back into one as we put this together and fit it. I'm hoping not to do that until the spring. I'd like to have it done by the time the weather warms up, but best laid plans and all that. So I thought in this video I'd show you some of the work I've done to get to this stage. The transfer case is basically now an assembly kit ready to build. I didn't show the strip down because it is quite self-explanatory really, and it's a bit boring and laborious getting all the parts cleaned up. This is far more interesting, so that's where we'll start. But in this video I'll take you through the work I've done, the parts I've had to buy, and the consumables kits that are available. So you've seen the case that's all cleaned up, a lot of hours in that. The painted parts have been away for shot blasting and powder coating, and they look really nice durable finish. There are actually some more bits to go, but there's one or two parts I need to track down. I took some parts off this transmission for the one that's now in WRD, so I'd quite like to track down all the spare bits so that I've essentially got two complete gearboxes and I can always keep one as a spare. Quite a few new bits inside. Most of the mechanicals are completely flogged in this one. It was with the army for 20 years and I guess spent a lot of its life on Salisbury Plains being thrashed about. This is a low gear wheel, and that's a high output gear wheel. And it's actually important that both are in good condition, because in high range they're both working together. Drive is transmitted thus, so it's important that there is a minimum of backlash. Being what it is, a fairly ancient design of transfer box, the clearances are fairly large, but nonetheless anything you can do to reduce them does reduce the noise in service. This is a new intermediate pin. These are the shims for the speedometer drive housing. Great pack of new old stock ones there. I struggled to get any of those until I contacted PA Blanchard's, I think it was, who sell a lot of surplus, and they've still got plenty of those in stock. The overhaul kits are stocked by a number of people. Some are showing out of stock at the moment, and that's because of these intermediate gear shims or thrust washers appear to be unavailable at the moment. It does seem like nobody's making them. These are steel backed and bronze faced, probably lead bronze, so they're a bimetal thrust washer, and they're actually quite a difficult thing to make. You couldn't make that at home very easily. The two metals have a very similar melting point. So, yeah, they're kind of difficult to obtain at the moment, and it took me many hours of looking to find some, and they were about £15 a piece when I did. So if anybody knows of a good source of them, it would be very good to hear that. The gasket set is the same that I used before, perfectly good. We've got a new old stock Leyland rear output shaft. Now this is the intermediate gear, and this looks pretty good. Now you can see here that we've got, in this case, the helical and spur type transfer box, and there are all helical transfer boxes, and the one ton boxes are also different again, so that's something to be aware of when ordering parts. Now, as I say, it looks good. The gears themselves are good, and the ground bore of the gear looks quite good, but running my finger around it, I can feel very slight roughness. And the reason for replacing the intermediate pin is that it appears one of the bearings has broken up at some time. So what I can feel there is bearing material that's become embedded in the surface. So I'm going to very carefully try and scrape some of that out if I can, because these are expensive and it's worth rescuing it if possible. It actually measures up really well. So certain parts need quite close inspection to determine if they're actually any good. I'm going for the perfect, as perfect a build as I can get, just simply because I want it to last. This is the drive dog for four-wheel drive high range, I believe. Those parts are perfectly serviceable. The front output shaft is one of the very few mechanical bits that's still any good. In there is a bronze bush, which is actually shared with the crankshaft spigot, same bush, so it might help if you're trying to track down one of those. And they don't seem to come in the overhaul kits. The selector rods are all pretty good, all cleaned up well. I've stripped these down and just polished them up as much as possible, re-split pinned. They do tend to suffer corrosion at these ends because the ends project from the case into this little tin cover, and they always get holes in. So the holes in this one have been soldered up. So it's important to clean all those up so that they don't seize up. I've also put a lot of time into cleaning up and blacking all the fixings just like they were when new. And they should look really nice. That's the speedometer drive pinion, that's all in really good order. And then there's a detent spring and plunger for the selector rod in the transfer box. Oh, and this is the gear that drives the speedometer pinion. If your speedometer's wandering all over the place and it's not the cable, very often it can be the rear output. Drive flange has come loose, the nut's gone slack. If that's happened, then the helical gear can actually spin on the shaft, and you can see that's what's happened here. So I'm probably going to grind this up and make it a nice flush surface again once I've checked there's enough clearance to do so. So quite a lot of work, a lot of hours put into preparing all those parts, and quite a bit of expenditure as well on the parts. So we'll go through the cost later on, which is not something I would normally do. But there is a reason for it. We'll come back to that. So I wouldn't normally go into costs, but there is a reason for it, and that's that there are quite a few people offering overhaul services for serious gearboxes and transfer boxes, and a lot of them, I think, are at a very low price. And I have to ask myself, what are you actually getting for that money? My total part spend to rebuild this transfer box is just over £360, and we can add another 100 to that if I have to buy an intermediate gear. So not a cheap exercise by any stretch. And as I say, I would think about who you get to overhaul your transfer box if you decide you can't do it yourself. There are lots of reputable rebuilders out there who do a lovely job, but I'd also be sceptical about the low price of some of the others. No, not having tried them, I don't want to slander anyone's good name, you know. just something I think you should be aware of. Anyway, shopforautoparts.net, I find them very good for Land Rover parts. I bought the overhaul kit and the gasket set from them. Brooklyn 4x4, I got the lock tabs for the mounting bracket nuts from them. McDonald Automotive Limited, Shropshire. The low gear wheel came from them. I think that was an eBay sale. Yeah, it was. PA Blanchard, they're very good for surplus parts, so I got all the shims from them, and you'll need a goodly selection of them to get your output preload just right. Old stock parts can sometimes be expensive, but you've got to have them. And paddocks, I've heard a lot of bad things said about paddocks, but I've never had a bad experience with them at all. Always good service, and they had a lot of the parts I needed, including a number of old stock bits, so again, very pleased with them. So that's what it's cost to get all the bits together. As I say, that may increase depending on anything else we find. It gives you some idea of what's involved. The gearbox is in a worse state, and there's a lot more parts in that. So, we'll go over the costs of that when I've done it. So I thought we'd just have a look at some of the parts to be replaced, or have been replaced, and why they've been replaced. So this here is the low gear wheel, and you can see that the teeth in here are very sharp, and so where the high gear wheel engages with it, you can see that the corners are all taken off. Sort of look at the curve on that tooth there. It's pretty well flogged. Then if we look at the shaft that it runs on, again, that's been subject to quite a bit of wear. And then the high output gear itself, the teeth are not really recognisable as gear teeth. They're just mangled. I would suggest it's been thrown in and out of low range while moving once or twice. And then we've got the thrust washers for the intermediate shaft, which you can see has suffered some sort of bearing failure at some time. So that's why I'm replacing that. Unfortunately, that is within the bearing track, so it is what it is. These are well flogged. The intermediate shaft, from memory, is allowed 1/8 thou float maximum, and the depth of those grooves is easily past that. These are the intermediate shaft bearings. Funny enough, they're in quite good nick, so I wouldn't wonder actually if it's possibly had new ones at some time. But they haven't replaced the pin. Front output shaft, front bearing, bit of wear in it, but it's not bad. And similarly, the main shaft, the rear output shaft bearings rather, they've got no oil or anything at the moment, but I've seen an awful lot worse. A little bit of corrugation, but they're not bad. I've seen an awful lot worse than that. So I'm just going to assemble these parts together, and you can then see how the wear in all those parts adds up and how it would cause an issue. Okay, so here we see the low range, or low gear wheel, in the low range position. First things first, these are actually normally quite loose on the shaft, and that's, even the new ones are like that, and they actually need a bit of clearance to slide neatly along those splines. Bear in mind there's heavy gear oil in there, but that is how they run. It's not unusual. You often see the question pop up on forums and so on, is this correct? Well, yeah, frankly, don't worry about it. What isn't so good here is all this, which results every time you put your foot on the accelerator, clunk as it takes up drive, every time you come off, clunk as you run the overrun. And then with a light throttle position, say coasting down a hill, it's all chattering around, making a hell of a din, which is not unusual. This one has some wear in the shaft as well, radially. So generally all very worn, and that's why I'm replacing all those parts. I think another thing that is worth mentioning is look at the condition of the gear teeth. Now these are actually quite good, but there's pitting in some of them, and pitting usually ends up resulting in failure somewhere down the line. Also, if you're pairing new parts with old, with gears particularly, sometimes they will never quieten down. You'll end up with a noisy transfer box, and that's just from past experience. Sometimes it's worth just replacing all the gears, and that's another reason I'm considering just replacing that intermediate gear shaft, just so it is all new, it all beds in together, hopefully results in a really nice quiet box. So this is my well-used Haynes manual. A lot of people slate these, but there's a lot of good information in here, and there is quite a lot of information on the series gearbox. Some things to be aware of, we'll come to that in a minute, but basically there are quite a lot of the figures that you need, end float settings and so on, that you'll need to know for overhaul, and good diagrams and so on. It's not a bad start, and it will take you through overhaul of the transfer box no problem. Lots of diagrams and so on that are shared with the Series 3 workshop manual, which is my preferred reading for this job. Lots of handy notes, lots of measurements, like that's a free length of the selector springs. Tells you sizes that things should be reamed to and so on. And also list differences between the various different types of transfer box. So that is quite a comprehensive thing. You can't really do better than that. If we go to the back of the Haynes manual, we've got this section, revisions and information on later models. And particularly if you own a post-1980 Land Rover, it's worth looking through, see if we can find a bit on the gearbox. There's various notes here on overdrives, gearboxes, and the differences of the various suffix of gearboxes. Not so critical with the transfer box. As I've said, there are differences. There are quite a lot more differences with the gearbox. So we'll come to that when we get to the gearbox itself. Always worth looking at the revisions, whatever job you're doing. So just to round up today's video, I thought that we would just have a look at identifying this gearbox. Obviously we've got a suffix D letter on the transfer box case, but there's nothing on the gearbox. There is, someone has etched somewhere on it, a 1982 build date, I remember that, which tallies in with what I know about the vehicle, and there is of course a Leyland logo and a ribbed case. So that gives us some idea as to its age. But there are lots of variations on the parts inside, and just to give you a simple example, that's a Suffix A Series 3 reverse gear. Obviously the shaft diameter is different when you have a Suffix D reverse idler with its needle roller. There are differences in these gear sets on the main shaft, and there are differences in the lay shaft. Now, in the back of the Haynes manual, there's quite a good section on some of the differences between gearboxes, and it tells you suffix A, B, C, and D. There's a lot there, a lot of information. Mine, I believe, to be a suffix D, so we need to have a look at the lay shaft, which is a good identifier here. And the book says here that the step length on the back of the lay shaft at the first gear end was reduced from 1.5 to just under 0.5 millimeter. And there's also some little recesses in the gear teeth on the input shaft, the primary pinion rather. So, confusingly, we have a letter C marked on the lay shaft. But if we look at the step at the back, this is a sure identifier of this type of lay shaft, a suffix D, that we have the reduced step. So we know this one's okay. So it identifies the gearbox as a suffix D. Finally, this is the primary pinion that came out. It's in pretty bad way, but you can see here that the teeth for the synchronizer have the little cutout. I'll try and zoom it in so you can see. So we can be pretty sure that we've got what we think we have, basically, and it hasn't been made up from bits or the gearbox and transfer box mismatched at some time, which can happen. This is a new primary gear set. You should always get them as a pair. Probably a better demonstration of those splines. This I picked up on eBay, new old stock, for a third of the price of a new one. So it's worth just searching part numbers every day while you're doing your gearbox build, or beforehand rather, and you can sometimes turn up bargains. Anyway, so that's how I've identified this gearbox as definitely a suffix D, and I know that I can order parts now, safe in the knowledge I'm not going to be wasting my money. So that's kind of it for today. The next video we're going to have a look at the front output shaft and changing that bronze bush, and we'll start the build from there. Hope the video has been of interest, and thank you for watching.